Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info.
The Greek writer Nikos Kazantzakis once said, "Since we cannot change reality, let us change the eyes which see reality." Today, countless thousands of inquirers are looking at the world and the universe beyond with changed eyes. When one gazes at our celestial neighborhood, the planets, moons, comets, and asteroids we see defy the speculative history we learned in school. These bodies testify to events not included in any geology textbook. The evidence seems undeniable. High-energy electromagnetic events have indelibly scarred, and in some cases devastated, the rocky bodies in our solar system. Today, this seemingly outrageous theory is being put to the test experimentally. One of the most remarkable of these experimentalists is Billy Yelverton, who has successfully replicated countless planetary features through experiments with electrical discharges and electric fields. Here we provide a brief overview and introduction of Billy's research. We begin with a discussion of an especially fascinating experiment that produced features resembling cellular structures, which are also seen on some planetary surfaces.
It started with the two copper conductors, or two metal conductors. The bottom plate was generally an iron plate we use in our tests, and the upper plate was happened to be a copper sheet, the first time that we noticed them. And it's during the time when we do the lifting effect, which raises these columns of sand or clay. And if you look under the plate after the discharge is over, what we found is that there tends to be some sort of condensation of moisture, either must be from the atmosphere or, you know, the humidity in the air. But however, it tends to, you know, condense in the sand and the clay there. It causes it to harden up, and it also causes it to cake up on the bottom of the electrodes in these same patterns that we see, you know, cellular shape, fairy circle. So it was pretty incredible to see that. To be honest, my jaw fell open, really. I really didn't know what to think. I called Ben up. He and I looked at the pictures and whatnot and discussed it. He put it in the morning news the next morning. The first thing that came to mind was cellular. You know, some sort of, I mean, this is a, I know we can't say it's biological because it's not at all biological, but nonetheless, it had a biological appearance to it. Central Africa has quite a bit of those fairy circle features. And the Giant's Causeway in Northern Ireland is where these columns, hexagonal columns, appear to be solidified into rock. If you imagine, look at them from above, these hexagonal shapes all bunched together, that's what they look like, you know, a cellular type feature. And we find them in soft sediment and in, you know, as we just explained, hard sediment too. Devil's Tower in Wyoming is another example.
Dating back decades, various experimentalists have replicated through electrical discharges different types of craters, from those indistinguishable from impact craters to anomalous craters that continue to puzzle planetary scientists. In some instances, an electrical discharge may be the only process capable of producing all of the features of certain craters.
The first types of craters were done with the dark mode discharge with a single overhead anode or cathode, actually. It doesn't really matter. And those were done again with dark mode. And then we've also created several crater chains. And singular craters through layered material with the lightning bolt with the arc mode. We get a lot of the same features. The rays that tend to scatter out quite a distance from the center of the crater. We created that quite a few times too. And the raised rim. You literally can't tell the difference between that and an impact.
In the Thunderbolts Project's documentary film, The Lightning-Scarred Planet Mars, it is proposed that the towering so-called shield volcano Olympus Mons is in effect a lightning blister from an enormous electrical discharge. Has Billy achieved similar features in his experiments?
We did a couple tries there with arc mode discharge on some clay that I mixed up with water beforehand, and almost like a mud, peanut butter texture to it. And those two produce, you know, of course, it's a gaseous effect. You know, we're heating the liquid up, turning it in back into gas again, and it kind of creates like a blister. And these do resemble limpus mons. They take on a concentric type ridge pattern as they like step up higher and higher as the center rises up. But again, that could be, you know, as a process of heat and, you know, steam and pressure creates what's similar, be similar to a volcano, actually. I mean, in my opinion, if you look at this whole thing overall, volcanoes are electric discharge. This is the induction mechanism here. This is what is causing the rock to turn to lava. The volcanoes all tend to be this lifted mechanism, similar to, you know, a blister or something like that, you know, a raised feature. It can be done with or without, you know, the arc mode. We've shown that too. But the long mountain ranges, I found that so far the best reproduction that I've done on the table is with the vibration, which in, you know, if we, you know, if we look at this type of cataclysmic event that may have actually happened, we'd have to associate some rather large earthquakes with some of these events anyway. And what I found is that most earthquakes take place today between, well, less than 1 hertz up to about 20 hertz in frequency. And I played around with that a little bit on the table with a vibrator, you know, just an offset counterweight. And I determined the frequency by calculating the RPM. And at about 25 to 30 hertz, we begin to do the exact same process as we see all over. We get raised dendritic features, raised mountain ranges with the feather back, you know, formations. And so that's another road I want to travel down here shortly, is to integrate this earthquake feature into our electric discharge. Because, well, we know that electricity carries these type frequencies with them. A lot of work that Ben Davidson's done is, you know, all but prove that electric discharge is what creates earthquake. So we'd have to assume sooner or later that they are integrated together.
Given the proven ability of electrical discharges and electric fields to produce familiar geological features, then much traditional geology must be reassessed. One intriguing example is the production of sand dunes by ionic wind. This opens the door to a new interpretation of mysterious sand dunes found on Mars, on the Saturnian moon Titan, and most stunningly, even on the comet 67P.
Those are quite common, actually. And if you watch this happen on a sheet of acrylic or any type of a dielectric sheet, yeah, I mean, it's right. It unfolds right before your eyes, literally. And you can see that it's an ionic wind that's created by the discharge that's doing this on the table. And to see it perform almost the same way we do in nature makes you, you know, really want a second, you know, opinion on what actually causes the wind to blow. Because the features are identical, whether it be, you know, what we consider to be weather-driven wind forces by heat and pressure. If we can recreate the same duning effects with nothing but electric discharge. It is incredible. And to find these type features on the 67P recently, that really speaks volumes when you know there's no atmosphere there.
For continuous updates on space news from the electric universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.